Our next speaker with his talk called Embrace Your Weirdness is about being an individual. He's the manager of Armagh Senior Football Team. Kieran has captained Armagh to a historic first and only All-Ireland title in 2002. He's achieved a huge amount and here to give us a little bit of a story. Please give a huge round of applause to Kieran McGeeney!
Weird that I have to follow an orthopaedic surgeon as I limp onto stage. I could be talking to you later, I could give you a week's work on my own. When I was first told I was going to take this talk by Patrick, I came up with the title Embrace Your Kinks. And so I sent that on, and when you back, I done a quick Google search as you said to do, and the pictures that came up, you can look at that later. I was, have to change that title very quickly. So I went on to Embrace Your Weirdness. And the thing about being weird is we're all weird. You're weird, I'm weird. But we don't realise we're weird because we live with ourselves, so we're sort of used to it. But other people are weird to us and we're weird to them. Maybe not all of them or not all of you, but there's parts of it. And it's something we just have to sort of learn to sort of get used to, or not even get used to, but embrace. Because when I give these sort of talks and go around a lot of sports teams and go to a lot of businesses, I used to talk about the word average. Like over the last 12 or 13 years of doing this, I've sort of come to realise not only was it a bad starting point, but it was a false starting point. I used to use it nearly as a derogatory term, like who wants to be average, like you should be pushed to be great. But the thing about it was, is I found, like, not just with research, but like just like in my everyday sort of work, that like it was a really false starting point. And I'm just going to give you a bit of a story to sort of illustrate this. In the 1950s, the US Air Force was going through a huge change. Jet engines had come into sort of the fighter planes. There was new technology, they were getting faster, more agile. But the problem with it was there were more crashes. And not only with the loss of life, but like with money as well, the US Air Force decided this, we need to sort of look into this and see why this is happening. So the commissioner fellow called Lieutenant Gilbert S. Daniels to look at this. And when Mr. Daniels came in, he sort of realised that the cockpit was the heart and soul of the plane, like, and it was based on the 1920s technology, but also the pilots. And after the Second World War, there was huge changes, not only in technology, but like in lifestyle and nutrition and stuff like that. There was huge changes in the pilots coming through too. So we decided to redesign the cockpits. And he wanted to base it all on the average of the modern day pilots. So he'd done all these sort of measurements, he had 10 basic measurements that he wanted to do to try and, what do you call it, like, to redesign the cockpits. Being a very diligent fella, a very curious fella, he wanted to see how many actual pilots fell in the middle range, the middle 30, what he would call the middle 30%. So he used over 4,000 pilots, 4,062 pilots to be exact, but he tried to see how many of those would fit in that middle 30% over those 10 dimensions. And the answer was, none. There wasn't one single pilot that was average in all 10 dimensions. And then he said, we'll sort of look at it a little bit deeper, and he decided to go, what about 3 dimensions? Just with the average across 3 of them. And again, less than 5% of those 4,000 plus pilots fell into that average section. So the conclusion he came to was that there was no such thing as average in reality. It's only a mathematical concept. There is nobody who is average right across the board. So what he actually came up with was the adjustable seat. And I know that doesn't sound a whole pile, but it was very innovative back then for a cockpit of a plane. But if we push on from that, in the 1970s there was a psychologist called Don Clifton, and he sort of took this and he sort of ran with it. And what he found out was that in terms of high performance and getting people to perform better, there was no such thing as the right pattern of abilities to show that you had high performance, but it was the right sum of abilities. So like, we all have kinks, we all have weirdness, like, we're not flat, we're not rounded, like, you know, we sort of have to get used to that. But the thing about it is the world has come up with this supremely effective technology to help integrate people with imperfect capabilities. It's called a team. And that can be in a marriage, a relationship, it can be a village, a city, work, it can be anything. But that's why we work well together as teams. And the magic of a team is that it makes weird useful. Not only does it make it useful, it makes it essential. And my job, well, half my job, sort of, I'm a manager, I don't know if it's a job or purgatory at different times, but it's to look at different people who can fit into this team. Where do they fit? And people think I'm going around and look at different players and want this well-rounded player that was good at everything. That's not the case. That's not even the case that it always comes down to technical ability. It's all different types of things. And just to give you sort of an example of that, I'm going to give you sort of like three athletes that I've sort of worked with over the last couple of years. The first fellow here is a fellow called Seamus Cannon. He was the captain of the Tipperary senior hurling team there that won it. But I worked with Seamus back in 2016, even when she had asked me to come in and sort of work with him. He asked me to speak to Seamus first. And at that time, Seamus was sort of up and coming, looking one of the stars. So I met Seamus for a coffee. My mate and I love going for coffee. It keeps me right. But so we sat down and he said, like, well, what do you think? When you're coaching somebody, you let them do the talking. And he says, well, I think Eamon has you here to work on your defence. I said, you think so? And he goes, yeah. And I said, what do you think, Dad? And he said, he thinks I have to work on it. And I said, right, we have the first league game coming up on Sunday, so let's accelerate this. Listen, you're brilliant. We work really well in your defence. And like Sunday comes, and I said, you play, you make three blocks, four hooks, three or four dispossessions, and you have a fantastic defensive game, but you don't score. What'll happen? And he goes, I'll probably get taken off. He said, but Eamon will be happy when you get taken off. And I goes, okay, well, let's flip it over. Let's say you don't make any blocks, no hooks, no dispossessions, but you score your normal 110, 111. What'll happen? And he says, oh, Eamon will probably be pissed off, but I'll probably get mad at the match. And I says, yeah. And I said, the thing about it is, you're here to do a particular job. It's not that we're not going to work on those things over here. But your key, the thing that you're good at, the thing that like, separates you from everybody else, is scoring. And that's what we're going to focus on. So look, and he goes, I can say that. So that's what we did. The next person here is Johnny Dyle. And as you can see from Johnny here, the muscles and all that, Johnny's not really a quintessential Gaelic footballer. And when I first met Johnny, it was a good sort of breath of fresh air, I would really knock him over. But what I learned was his kink or his bit of weirdness was that he never quit. He just never gave up. Ever. I never seen anybody like him. But when I got to sort of know him a wee bit better, I found out why. Over the years that Johnny never made the academy squads, never made underage, never made under 21s. And he used to go with his dad, like his dad played for there for a while, and then only played in the 40s. But Johnny always came with bigger, stronger, faster, better opponents. And what Johnny learned to do was he just loved it. He just loved the fact that he could join in here, but he never stopped, never quit. I have never seen anybody like him at training. He just kept going and going. It's just a perpetual motion. And what happened was he became one of the best forwards of his generation through that particular kink in his personality. And the last one, this fellow I love, Benny would love him if he's seen this picture. Benny definitely is not an athlete. And that picture definitely doing him no favours. But Benny was goalkeeper for Mullaghbawn, the club I played for. He was also the goalkeeper for Armagh when we won the All-Ireland. And as you can see, if you were picking somebody out of a line-up for a modern-day Gaelic football, Benny wouldn't be the first person you'd sort of pick. But he was unbelievable keeper. Serious keeper. And it wasn't because of his technical ability, it was because he could talk. In fact, if you walked through the gates of training, if you listened, you could hear Benny talk above everybody else, even before you got to the changing room. And he was brilliant at it. He was funny, but he made our team. Not only made our team, but he was the bedrock on which our defence was built around. And our defence at that particular time was regarded as the best and meanest defence of that generation. I think we averaged less than 11 scores per game. But it was all built around his communication. And he knew he was good at it, and it was that quirk, that piece of weirdness that made him stand out. But this is the thing about teams, when people want to talk to you, I know you're at school now and people want to make you a better rounded individual. They want to make sure, sometimes they want to try and file those kinks down. And it's funny, you sort of have to look at it, you have to make sure, you have to hold on to that. And it's not only in sport, but in business too. I'll tell you a story about a fellow called Joe. Joe was this young fellow who started a business, it was Yellow Pages, but at that particular time, he integrated with mapping technology. And it was a great idea, this was before Google Maps and all that sort of stuff, so it sort of took off, he got some venture capitalists behind him. But as the venture capitalists, when they came in, they wanted to have their sort of say, and they took over the board, and they didn't like Joe, we didn't fit in, it was a wee bit weird. Too weird, in fact, so they kept moving him around, they put him into this section, put him into that section. And Joe sort of felt like he was being sort of demoted, and he basically was, because they didn't think he was the perfect fit for this company. Anyway, it was bought over, as that happens, Joe decided that then he moved on. Even though he was the founder, he didn't like it, he didn't seem to fit in, so he moved on. He started a financial service business. And again, hard work and perseverance, definitely needed, as from our last speaker, regardless of what your kinks or what your twists or weirdness is. But he started this financial service again, he built it up, got it up, another company wanted to take over, they came in. They, like, again, he had to stay on to make sure that this, what I call it, was working, but again, he was pushed around. He was moved over here, he didn't fit, he didn't sort of seem right, they just didn't like the fit of him in this organisation. And again, eventually he moved on. He moved on this time to a mechanical engineer for the company. This is Joe Romney. Anybody know who he is? Elon Musk. And anybody who does Twitter or any of that sort of stuff would know he is weird. But because he loved his weirdness, because he held on to that, because he wouldn't let anybody file it down, he was a success. And not only was he a success, but he was happy. And now a sixth former user coming in, and the whole world is in front of you, and people are wanting to try and change you. Those kinks that you have that may not like, even your classmates might like. And the thing about it is, you get consumed by that because you want them to like you. You let them file it down if you want more likes or dislikes or whatever it is, so you let them change you. And the thing about it is, you can't. You can't let people sort of change it. You have to hold on to those kinks. And you're probably sort of thinking, you know, well, like, I don't want to be like, but it's such a small cross-section. If you take your class, 30, 40 people, or your teachers, 15, 20 people, and you compare that to the Northern Ireland, 1.5-2 million people, look at this small cross-section that is, the people of Ireland, 5 or 6 million, or the UK. So just because they don't see your weirdness or your kinks fitting in here doesn't mean it won't fit in somewhere. It will. But you have to hold on to it, you have to embrace it, you have to love it. And I know you're thinking, oh, yeah, I'll do that, I'm struggling. But you won't. Reality shows us that we bend, we change, let people file us down. There was a famous test in the 1960s called Conformance of Norm by a fellow called Solomon Nash. And what he sort of said on that particular thing was he wanted people to say, what lane met what lane? And everybody said, yeah, that's right, C matches that. And everybody did it. But over 12 tests, he put different people into the room with them. They sort of say, oh no, it's B or it's A. And 75% of the time, at least one occasion, they bet, they went. And in this modern day of age, this modern age where we have Twitter, Facebook, where everybody's looking to be liked and wanted and being told that they're this, that, and the other, and this is perfect life, you will let people file you down. But what I'm here to say today is, do not let them file you down. Do not let them take those kicks. Do not let them suppress your weirdness. Hold on to it, embrace it, because as human beings, our innate thing is to make a difference in this world, to want to be better, to want to be more. And the difference that you have is the difference that's going to make a difference in the world. Maybe not the whole world, but definitely in your world. So what I'm saying is, do not let them fight you down, do not let them change you, do not look for likes, be yourself, embrace your weirdness. Thank you.
Kieran, I'll just ask you a question before you go. Kieran, I suppose, what would you say to a student in the room now who doesn't feel like they have a tribe, doesn't feel like they have a team somewhere where their weirdness fits in?
Just keep going. You'll find it somewhere. Like, you know, I've been lucky enough with sport. I've travelled all over the world and I've seen some weird stuff. And some of it you can't talk about or write about it, but there's so much out there and you will fit in somewhere. And not only will you fit in, but you'll be revered for it. Because individuality is something like that, you know, you have, it's the only thing you have. If you try to be somebody else, even if you're brilliant at it, the very best would be your second best at it.
I think it's a brilliant note. Let's hear for Kieran, everybody. Thank you so much, Kieran.